This program was funded in part by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting. The following program demonstrates that much about the interior structure of a planet can be determined indirectly. The program also explores the methods used to probe the interior of the Earth.
Read the note again.
My secrets within you must seek out. But spare my skin or break my heart.
No signature on the note. And no one saw it arrive. Yet it wasn't there when I went for breakfast at 8:06. And Scroggins, the newsboy, would have seen it arrive after 8:15. Most intriguing. Most unusual. I've never seen anything like it before.
Perhaps the note is a code. You know, some sort of message.
Not likely, no. Whoever sent us this pretty puzzle means for us to probe its interior. The note simply provides the rules of the game.
Well, how can we find out what's inside if we can't open it and look inside?
By inference, old mole. By inference! We must learn what we can from the surface, and then see if that allows us to draw any conclusions about what may be beneath.
Look here, old man, we've been at it for hours. As far as I can see, we've precious little to show for our efforts. The representatives of the Royal Society will be here tonight.
Patience, old fish. Now, let's go back to the beginning and summarize what we've learned so far.
Most of the surface is damp. However, there are raised portions that are dry. There is also a thin film of ice at either end. There's a good deal of variation in surface temperature, and very exact measurement shows that the sphere is ever so slightly pear-shaped.
Go on.
I don't see where this is getting us. What does it tell us about the interior?
Patience, old pup. What else do we know?
Well, when you weighed a tiny sample of the surface material, we noticed it didn't weigh enough to account for the entire weight of the sphere.
Aha!
What does that tell us?
Elementary! It tells us the material of the interior must be heavier than the surface material. The sphere is not made of the same substance all the way through.
That's not very much.
Then we shall have to learn more. Have you a thermometer?
Thermometer? I say, what for? Oh, yes. One moment. Here it is.
Now, we have determined that the temperature varies across the surface, but not whether it changes as we move inward. So just take a moment. Amazing. Let me see. We'll try this little hole here. Now. Ha ha! just as I suspected.
What?
The temperature increases very sharply just below the surface. Now, let me see what else we have here. Gadgets. Pills. A mallet. Aha! A stethoscope. The very thing. A compass. Going hiking, old boy?
It's for my nephew's birthday. If you must...
Shh!
What?
Please. There it is again.
I didn't hear anything.
Very slight rumbling at infrequent intervals. If only there was some way to measure them more accurately. By Jove, I think we'll beat this thing yet.
Well, it beats me, at least for the moment. I want some tea. You've been poking around that thing for hours. Are you on to something?
Let's find out. If you, Doctor, will be so kind as to draw the drapes, I will adjust these mirrors. That's about right. All right now. All right now. The mallet, please, Doctor.
You left it in my chair.
Quite so, thank you. Our magic lantern show is about to begin.
It's all done with the mirrors, eh?
Now watch. I've discovered two types of vibrations within this sphere, which I call primary and secondary. The primary vibrations travel through solids, liquids, and gases. The secondary vibrations travel only through solids. Now watch the light on the left. It moves only in response to the primary vibrations. They occur from time to time spontaneously, but I shall duplicate them with this mallet.
It moved twice.
Excellent, my dear fellow. You really do show promise on occasion.
These primary waves of yours travel at two different speeds through the sphere?
Correct.
But I don't see why.
Wait a minute. Hello. What's this?
What?
When I tap here, near the mirrors, I get both primary and secondary vibrations. When I tap here, on the opposite side of the sphere, I get only primary vibrations. And they take longer to arrive than one would expect. I feel both these facts are most significant.
Well, what if you tapped about halfway between the two?
Let's try.
Go ahead, I'm watching.
I did. I'll do it again.
They aren't moving.
Incredible. All right. Open the drapes. Thank you.
I say, old chap. Which way is north?
That way.
I just noticed the compass. The compass needle should be pointing north, but it isn't. It's pointing toward the sphere.
By heaven, old man. You've just found the missing piece to our puzzle. What a fool I was not to have seen it earlier.
Oh, it's nothing. Seen what?
All your questions will be answered here tonight, at a meeting of the Royal Society.
Thank you.
Good evening, chap.
Oh, good evening.
Well then, gentlemen, to begin. This object was mysteriously delivered to me early this morning, along with this note, which challenged me to probe its interior without disturbing the surface. I was forced to rely entirely on what I could learn from the surface and my powers of inference. First, the surface material is less dense than the sphere as a whole. From this, we conclude the inner material must be more dense than the surface material. Second, the temperature of the sphere increases very sharply immediately beneath the surface. If this continues all the way to the center, the core must be at a temperature of 3,000 to 6,000 degrees Celsius. At that temperature, almost all materials will have liquefied. Now, I detected two types of vibrations within the sphere. I was able to duplicate them with the good doctor's mallet and separate them with the mirror arrangement which you've already seen. The first thing I noticed was that the primary vibrations, which travel through solids, liquids, and gases, were traveling at two different rates of speed through the sphere. Now, I knew that the waves traveled faster through the denser material. The waves arrive in two discrete bursts. This led me to suspect that there are two layers beneath the surface. One, two. The primary waves, which travel through the low rogue, through the denser material, arrive first. Further work should allow us to pinpoint the boundary and figure the relative density of the two layers. Now, fourth, when I generated primary and secondary waves at various points on the sphere, I noticed that the secondary waves, which pass only through solids, could not pass through the core. From this, I induced that the core must be liquid, though there may be a smaller solid inner core. I also noticed a delay in the transmission of the primary waves, from which, knowing how their speed relates to the density of their medium, I was able to guess at the density of the core. Now, I discovered a shadow zone where no waves could be detected. Here, this allowed me to determine the dimensions of the core. I detected primary and secondary waves here, no waves here, and only primary waves here. This is why. You'll notice the waves can proceed along path A and path B with no trouble, although B just misses the core. A primary wave proceeding along path C would be refracted here as it enters the core and here as it leaves the core and emerge here. No waves can emerge here, and only primary waves can follow path C and path D. Now, knowing where the zone begins, where the wave just misses the core, gives us the radius of the core. The final piece of information, which my colleague discovered, was that the sphere generates a magnetic field. This suggested to me that the core might be of a magnetic material, perhaps iron or nickel. Now, gentlemen, what have we discovered about the interior of this sphere? It has a boundary right below the surface. It gets hotter and denser right down to a large core of molten metal. These are only the basics. The problem is far more complex than I have indicated. What I wish to emphasize is my method. I reasoned from the known to the unknown, much as I would in solving a crime. From the known, the corpse and the clues, to the unknown, the identity of the murderer. The process is the same, and I suspect that every good detective is at heart a scientist, and every good scientist a detective.
Well done. You've answered every question.
Not really. I haven't answered the two most important questions of all.
What questions?
Where did it come from? And what earthly good is it?
I haven't the foggiest notion.
Neither have I, old chap. Neither have I.